Oh, excellent. Fantastic. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, thank you very much for coming and supporting our event today. What an absolute tremendous turnout, not only by you guys, but also by the locomotives. I think you'll agree, quite a splendid display. We've got a little bit of an event for you now, which hopefully will give you plenty of photographic opportunities. We've got some special guests, and we're here to celebrate 40 years of the magnificent Class 43 high-speed train. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce to the stage Andy Mellors, our engineering director for GWR. Andy.
Thank you, Paul. Good morning. As Paul says, I'm Andy Mellors, engineering director at Great Western Railway. What a privilege it is to be able to be here today and say a few words. A very, very warm welcome to everyone here at St. Phillips Marsh. Fantastic open day celebration, and as Paul says, marking 40 glorious years of the high-speed train. Before I get into the main bit of my speech, I'd just like to say an immense thank you to everyone who has been involved in making today happen. A huge, huge logistical exercise, and you've pulled it off. And specific thanks to Simon Cassidy, who has led the team here at St. Phillips Marsh. Thank you and well done all. The team have brought together an incredible collection of locomotives, with many of them having played an important part in making the railway which Brunel built all those years ago one of the greatest in the world. And the depot here at St. Phillips Marsh dates back to 1910, when it was designed to meet the ever-growing demands of the Great Western Railway, and in particular at that time the many great freight locomotives of the day. But in the 1970s, a new chapter opened on the depot, with it moving into the high-tech era with the arrival of those high-speed trains. And today, St. Phillips Marsh is one of seven maintenance depots that we have across GWR, not just here looking after the high-speed train fleet, but also our regional diesel fleet that works as far afield as Portsmouth, Brighton, and down into Devon and Cornwall, as well as serving the local communities here in Bristol. It really is a true 24/7 depot. Only this morning, 5-6 o'clock this morning, the guys and girls here are servicing trains, putting them into service. And this year, I guess as a leap year, we can add another day to the 365 that it's normally operational. A dedicated workforce of over 200 people work here, keeping the trains fit and clean to go out on our network, working tirelessly to keep people moving. And when Brunel set out about creating the Great Western Railway, it was to forge better links with the communities of the South West and also into London. And today, those links are more important than ever before. And the high-speed train really has been at the heart of our network, bringing communities closer together. And the trains are still going strong after all these years. The last year we've just had on Great Western, the best ever year for performance of the trains, which is a true testament to the skill and expertise of those who have been involved in their original design and the maintenance and overhaul of them over the years. And today it's not just about celebrating the machines, it's also about celebrating the men and women who have been involved in the maintenance and upkeep of the fleet over all these years. When they came into service in October 1976, they were a step change in capacity, and quite rightly they were proved extremely popular. A few interesting stats: we've got 119 high-speed train power cars in the fleet here at Great Western, more than any other operator, and between them we reckon they've covered nearly half a billion miles in their lifetime. We're proud to operate more of these high-speed trains than any other operator, and we're also proud of those who work on them. The power car that we're naming here today is a very special one. After the prototype power car over there had been built, this one was the first production power car off the production line all those years ago. And we think it's racked up just shy of 9 million miles in those 40 years. And for those with a calculator, you can work out that that's 36,000 return trips between Bristol and London. And it's very fitting that soon this power car will stand next door to the prototype power car, and we at Great Western Railway are truly honoured that it'll be carrying the name of its designer, Sir Kenneth Grange. Next year is going to see the start of a new era of high-speed intercity train travel for the Great Western Network when our new Hitachi intercity express trains enter service. So once again, that'll be a step change in train travel, more seats, more trains, and quicker journeys. So now, without further ado, I'd like to welcome our guest of honour to the stage. It gives me great pleasure to invite Sir Kenneth Grange to say a few words and name this locomotive. Sir Kenneth.
Well, thank you, Andy. And I don't do this very often, but when I have done, the worst thing that can happen is that people don't hear you. So, is anybody over there not hearing us? I think that's a thumbs up, so I'll carry on. Well, Andy, you're very kind to let me come here today and to treat me in this way. It doesn't happen very often in a lifetime, and I'm thrilled to bits. And GWR is a remarkable company, but also remarkable in being such a big factor in the ongoing success of this one vehicle. And it was quite properly called God's Wonderful Railway, and I think it deserves that. So I got one or two things to say, and particularly to repeat how grateful I am to GWR, and through you, Andy, I'd like you to make sure all your colleagues know that. And I've got another couple of thank yous to add, if I may. The other one is to that bunch of railway enthusiasts, more than enthusiasts, nutters really, who there's probably 20 or so of them who spent years and years of their own time, their own energies, and effectively therefore their own money, and with certainly help from allies around, but that bunch of guys found that thing, that one over there, in sort of in a fairly decrepit state on its way to the knacker's yard. And they rescued it, and so from a historic point of view, it will, I think, last as long as its subsequent children, which are the HSTs. But it is a terrific achievement, and I think that group, which they call the 125 group, deserve a very, very particular thanks, and history, I'm sure, will show that. So that's the other thank you. Thank you. And the third thank you is to British Rail. I used to do little jobs for British Rail in the 1960s, and by a set of happy accidents, I got the chance to design a train. Up to that point, I'd only done the odd fountain pen and the odd kitchen mixer, so it was a big act of faith. But that is really the heart of the point I want to make, which is that those were really golden years for the idea of modernising Britain, and it had come into the hands of not many big institutions, but of them all, British Rail had the most forward-thinking, the forward-looking, the most outward-looking, the most modernistic view of the future. Now, of course, they suffered a great deal of bad press in long years because what they wanted to do would naturally take a very long time. But they set about it, and as an example, at Derby, they built complete new blocks to house the engineers who, up to the time of the HST, were working on the APT. And the HST, as you all know, came out of the, as it were, failure, or the seeming difficulty of making the APT into a real ongoing business. So the HST was born, and it fell into, or came into the hands of some clearly wonderful engineers, and who as remarks made a moment ago by Andy, who actually invested this train with such high calibre of design and engineering design that it's actually become one of the not easiest, but a very important factor is the relative ease of maintenance of this fleet. So there's a big factor. But these were the golden years of design in this country. That's the 60s and 70s, and I started work on it in 68, I think, and eventually, as you know, it ran in the early 70s. But those were really amazing years. We saw other things, for example, signage, motorway signage. We take it for granted now, but it became a sort of a world standard, the quality of our motorway signage. At the time, the railways were using other designers. One particular firm called DRU had originated this very, I think, absolutely brilliant device, the zigzag arrow, zigzag lines, and when you see it on the side of a vehicle in that form, it does show you why it became imitated right across Europe. The Dutch, the Danish, other railways actually virtually copied that 100%. So there's another example of British ingenuity and very, very elegant design thinking. And so that I'm not going on too long, one final anecdote for you. At the time I was working on the train, it was a brilliant summertime. And unlike today, I used to be really quite a flash dresser.
Still are.
Thank you. Put me off my stroke completely. but they were in a way. What I was talking on about British Rail and the dynamic of design in those years was clearly evident in terms of fashion and style and so on. So you had the King's Road and the flash dressers, including Grange. And at the time of the train, it was a wonderful summertime, wonderful sunny day. And I used to go regularly to Derby to attend to all the umpteen details that was part and parcel of the design process. And at the time, I used to be very fond of a pink suit made of denim. I thought I looked pretty bloody smart in this suit, I can tell you. Anyway. So I used to go regularly up to Derby, and we'd spend a happy day there. And about 2 years ago, so now jump on for a long, long time, a couple of years ago, I was at some party or something fair, and a chap came up to me, younger than I, and he said, you don't know me, but I was one of the engineers who worked on the HST in Derby. And he said, do you remember that office block you used to visit? And of course I did. And he said, well, our working floor was there. And the guard at the gate would let us know when you were coming. And you used to stride down the driveway in your pink suit. And we all went to the window just to take the pee out of you. anyway, it was one of life's rich pleasures, my pink suit and everything that was going on at that time, fantastic. Anyway, I'm greatly honoured, and that's more than enough for me. Thank you.
Okay, now what we want to do is a very special unveiling now. So I'm just going to ask Sir Kenneth if he can sound this horn. Thank you very much. And we should hear. Thank you. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure you'll agree it looks absolutely magnificent. Let's have a big round of applause for it, please. Now, Sir Kenneth spoke very eloquently about the 125 group who have done such a fantastic job of preserving the prototype, and I'd now like to introduce chairman of that group, Gary Healis.
Thank you very much, everyone. I'm not going to say very much because try and get things done before the gods go against us. But I'd like to present the commemorative nameplate to Sir Kenneth, simply for 40 years of travelling pleasure around Great Britain. Sir Kenneth. It obviously does pose the question. I mean, thrilled to bits and completely unexpected. Where do I put it? A friend of mine who's very successful in our trade, and he collected umpteen gongs and diplomas and things, and he made his laboratory the home for all of those diplomas and things. But I don't have a loo big enough. Perhaps over the end of the bed. Anyway, suggestion would be pretty welcome. Thanks very much.
I'm sure your darling lady wife might have something to say about it at the end of the bed. We'd like to do another presentation as well. On behalf of St. Phillips Marsh and the organising committee of the Open Day, we'd like to make a presentation to Andy Mellors. This locomotive carries two plates. It carries the Sir Kenneth Grange plate, and it also carries a special 40-year commemorative plate, and we'd like to present that to Andy Mellors now. David. Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our ceremony for today. The barriers will be removed shortly, and you will be able to get up close and personal with this locomotive. Very much, thank you very much for attending today. I hope you enjoy it. Enjoy the rest of the day, and please take as many pictures as you can. And if you are tweeting today, please use the hashtag SPM Open Day. Thank you very much. Enjoy yourselves.